This is a very important edition of Yojana, and we have been covering Yojana in detail, but this talks about international relations. Every time in your prelims, you have at least 1 to 2 questions talking about, let's say, G8, G20, BRICS, who are the members, who are not the members, so let's say there are 5 countries, 8 countries given, which of the following pair says these are not the members. So those are the kind of questions, and this is a special edition of Yojana, so becomes very, very important for your upcoming examination. Now, India has been constantly trying to have good foreign relations or good international relations with most of the countries. Neighborhood first policy has been very, very important. Vasudev Kutumbakam, where we say world is one, and Nishkam Karm, where we say good deeds bring good results automatically. India has been conducting numerous virtual meetings after the COVID lockdown, and since then we have seen a lot of cooperation on the international front as well. So our model for development basically focuses on banking systems, economy, focuses on defense, nuclear ties, technological development, and defense. So those are the major segments. Definitely, Russia is one of our leading partners for most of those. And then we have various grants and aid flowing across from different regions of the India. Now, India has recently released the Vande Bharat Mission. So Vande Bharat Mission basically aims to bring back the Indians who wish to be back from the nations they are residing in as of now. Now, ASEAN is the Association for Southeast Asia Nations. It is a group of economic, political and security cooperation. You have the following nations who are member of it. And there are various summits which basically focuses on road, maritime security and interconnectivity as the basic aim. Also, we have the defense ministerial meeting of the ASEAN that has come up. With Africa, we are having nearly 2/3 of the lines of credit going to African countries. With US, we have a comprehensive global strategic partnership, which basically aims on 3 aspects: defense, security, and counterterrorism. Similarly, with European Union, we are having a good strategic partnership and a roadmap for 2025. With Russia, as we said, we have a special partnership mainly with defense, nuclear ties, technology, and energy segment. 70% of India's army hardware, 80% of navy, and 85% of air force hardware comes from Russia. So Russia is definitely one of the leading partners. Also, Russia has given and promoted India for the membership for NSG, the nuclear suppliers group. Russia has always been supporting India, and it was also supporting India for a permanent position in Security Council. So that's again something that's very, very important. Coming on to the next is, when it comes to the front of Belt and Road Initiative, Russia is definitely taking the side of China as of now, and India is refusing the same. So there has been a kind of disruptions on the same. With China, India has a lot of economic ties, a lot of imports and exports, but of recent, due to the Galwan Valley dispute and the disputes at LAC, there has been defense issues that have been going on. So what we require is a kind of diplomatic move for settling down this issue. The next is regarding Nepal. Now, India-Nepal, we had the 1950, the India-Nepal Treaty for Peace and Friendship that was signed against the China Civil War. Also, Indian Aid Mission was there, which was renamed as Indian Cooperation Mission, and later on embassy merged with the embassy as the Economic Cooperation Wing. So those have been development from Indian fund. With Nepal, we have Tribhuvan, that's the common name you should remember. So you have the Tribhuvan Highway, Tribhuvan University, then you have Tribhuvan Airport, and then 5 major other airports that India has built up with Nepal, and the extent to the health sector has been immense. Also, you have numerous hydroelectric power projects, mainly on Kosi and Gandak, that we have been working with Nepal. The next is with Bhutan. We have a western highway connecting Thimphu and Phitsanulok, which is on the Indo-Bhutan border. And then we also have small development project scheme for health purposes. There have been various HEP projects. Jal Dhadka is one of the major projects. Similarly, With West Asia, we have Link and Act West Asia policy that is important, mainly focusing on cyber security and maritime issues. Iran, Afghanistan are some of the major factors that India is focusing on, major countries that India is focusing on, and mainly with the relations with oil and gas have become important. India is also a leading member for International Solar Alliance, and India has given a thrust to West Asia to join the International Solar Alliance. Abraham Agreement is important between UAE and Israel, and it's a kind of diplomatic relations between the two nations. The next is India's participation in the intra-Afghan negotiations. So there have been major roles that India has playing in partnership with Afghanistan for more than 400 projects that have been ongoing. And also we are working on various projects with India getting a lead into the non-permanent member of Security Council for 2-year term starting 1st January 2021. We are also giving a thrust for India to join as a permanent member, increase the number of seats for the UN Security Council for permanent members. Also, we are working on presidencies for G20, BRICS and SCO. Terrorism and countering terrorism has been one of the major focuses. Besides that, cyber development and biological domains have been another major focus. India has been supplying lots and lots of medicines, mainly the hydrochloroquine and paracetamol globally. Operation Sagar and Operation Sanjeevni have been some of the major operations from India. Now coming on to the COVID pandemic, India has rapidly evolved and adopted to telemedicine, tele-education and work from home culture. In terms of geopolitics, we have seen India's economy growing, but of recent there has been a contraction of GDP that has been seen. China has been spending more on research and development than United States and has been having a great hold on the regions closer to Taiwan. So there is kind of geopolitical issues that are there, and we have discussed those in our class on geopolitics and the geopolitics in detail in the separate session. So just go through that. Now, under the Belt and Road Initiative, China is also trying to develop numerous ports. Some of the major ports it has been working on is Djibouti in Africa, Gadar Port in Pakistan, and the Hamban Tota port in the region of Sri Lanka. Also, the military expenditure of China has significantly increased much closer to United States, and there has been a lot of technological inflow that has been seen. When it comes to global trade, India's trade has been important since the previous times. Since the time of Arthashastra, we have been talking about India's relation with West and Southeast Asia, export of raw cotton, spices and kind of finished products flowing into India have been recorded in history. GATT had been an agreement of general agreement on trade and tariff. Then this was started in 1948, and later on this was subsumed as part of World Trade Organization, WTO. India was one of the founding members of GATT, and there were 8 rounds which mainly focused on subsidies for agriculture and the dumping of agricultural produce that was there. There are 3 articles that become very, very important: Article 1, 20 and 24. So 24 basically talks about bilateral preferential trade agreements, 20 talks about protecting the life and restraining the imports, and 1 talks about the MFN, which is the most favored nation, very, very important. There is a separate lecture on MFN on Test Prep YouTube, so just go back and refer that for more details. Later on, as we said, GATT was subsumed under WTO, and India along with 76 other countries was the founding member for WTO. There were various rounds of agreements that were there. For agriculture, you had the Uruguay round that was very, very important, and the aggregate measurement of support became very, very important. Then you had the various boxes. The Ember box is one of those which talks about input subsidies. Now these various boxes are important under WTO. There was a question in 2018, I believe, which was on the Ember box. So the kind of WTO and the various subsidies under WTO regime becomes important. Doha development round started in 2001, and then we talked about a permanent peace clause which was to pursue agriculture domestic support programs. Similarly, there have been various reforms for WTO which are mainly for withdrawing the special and differential treatment and development across various nations. Tariff and non-tariff barriers have become important. The rates and the peaks have been varying for those. Now talking about the free trade agreement, free trade agreement is an agreement between two countries such that there is end to tariff and non-tariff barriers on significant value of imports from the receiving country or the partner nation. So the free trade agreement basically talks about opening up the market, giving in better relations between countries and improving technology and investments between the nation. Also, we have been focusing on machine learning, AI, robotics, big data analytics as some of the major terms we have already talked about. In terms of India international trade, some of the largest producers are given here. So those would be available in the handouts as well in case you want to refer into more detail. So just go back, and then you have the five largest exporting countries and importing countries for goods from India. So the list of those is again given. Important, sometimes direct hierarchy is asked. Now, what have been the reason for such a high growth of world trade that has been seen after World War II? That was mainly because of the development in technology, science and communication. India has signed nearly 10 free trade agreements with SAARC nations, Japan, South Korea and ASEAN. Also, we have seen that the trade volumes have declined as of recent because of the COVID and the lockdown that has been seen. Infrastructure, in terms of infrastructure, we have been doing wonderful. Bharatmala, Sagarmala are some of the schemes. Sagarmala for the coastal areas, Bharatmala for the road. Both of those have been covered separately in a detailed lecture. So just go back and cover those. Then coming on to the Indian Commercial Mission, the idea is to promote exports. So you have the various SECs established. The export promotion councils have been established, various trade associations have come into line, and then we are also talking about board of trade which engages with the leader of industry. Ease of doing business and IT initiatives have been important. So SWIFT has been one of the major ways through which you have easy clearance that has been seen. Now if we talk about this major export promoting schemes, we have for the raw materials, sourcing of the capital goods and enhancing the schemes. So MISC is one of the schemes for specified projects. Then you have EPCG and the advance authorization under the Exporters Import Importing Most Raw Material Act. Now again, we have duty refunds and neutralization schemes that have come up. So three important schemes under this: advance authorization, duty free import and duty drawback scheme, where the refunds of the customs to be paid on the input is being done. So all these three schemes, very very important, must for your examination, prepare those thoroughly. Very very expected question for your next upcoming prelims. The next is merchandise export and service export schemes from India have come into play. We are also talking about SEZs, trade infrastructures, as we have already discussed. Made in India is another initiative. So we have been focusing on reducing the cost. Apple online store has come into India as one of the landmarks for this effort, where the prices have been significantly reduced. Again, WTO and the developments under WTO have been important in terms of administration, in terms of providing a forum for negotiations, settling down the trade related disputes, and various review mechanisms have been taken into account. Now, General Council and the various committees have been mapped here, so those would be available in the handout. You can just refer that for more details. But there are significant challenges coming up or being faced by the World Trade Organization. Specifically, after the Doha round, there have been negotiations that have been increased significantly. The role of Director General, who is the head or the secretariat of who heads the secretariat of the World Trade Organization, has been important. His role and his power have been taken into account significantly. So what is the role of DG can be a expected question for your mains as well. So important question for your mains under WTO and the discussions under WTO. Now India and H-1B, the visa issues have been very very important. So under this model we have mode 1 and mode 2. Mode 1 talks about cross-border supply. Mode 4 talks about the movement of natural persons. That's where you you have the visa issues that basically flow in. So there have been modalities where we have been talking about India's export through various segments, and mode 4 remains one of the major segments, mainly for the engineering related technical services, and that's one of the major segments for the H-1B program in US. The IT companies have been outsourcing, various IT firms have been outsourcing from India, and numerous visa have been accounting to companies like TCS. Then you have Amazon as well, which has visas, but less as compared to TCS. Similarly, the significance of mode 4, as we said, is very, very important, because you have various Indian companies who are sending people on H-1B visa, companies sending people on L-1 visa. So again, these visas are on stake. So this visa reforms would definitely have a significant impact. The labor condition and applications have become very, very important in light of the recent changes and the political upheavals in US as of now. So again, a very important question for this time's mains is on H-1B visa reforms. So second most important question that we have talked about, the prelim section, what is important, the advanced section, the schemes, the duty drawback scheme that we have discussed. So that's very, very important for your prelims. So we are marking out the sections that you have to focus on, mains and prelims this time, on request of a lot of people this time. The next is the major issues with diaspora. Now, Indian diaspora is spread across nearly whole of the globe, and there have been issues with language, education, health, special behavior that has been seen, and therefore there has been a need to bring about changes and the issues related to those. So for example, the Khalafa labor system, which is considered exploitative, has been raised into concern. The norms for H-1B visa have got strict, and therefore again a kind of narrowing down of the global relations, we could say. Dual citizenship has been another important aspect that we are trying to focus on, and most of the diaspora that is abroad aim to retain the dual citizenship as they have. Now, the next important thing that we focus on is the Pravasi Bharatiya Divas, which started in 2003, and since then has been working significantly. More than 43 countries have been permitted for visa on arrival by the Indian government. These includes United States, Australia and Fiji. Also, we have seen Operation Rahat, Operation Sankat Mochan, which have been important. Pravasiya Kaushal Vikas Yojana has been another important scheme that has been released. Now, the next important highlight is education and internationalization of higher education. Now, we are planning to bring universities like Yale, Harvard into India, and the idea is to promote internationalization of higher education. We have also brought in significant changes with national education policy. We are giving thrust to private universities to have stronger memorandum of understanding with foreign universities. So bringing in more mobility and exchange of students, collaborative programs, then we are talking about building more new higher educational institutions which could bring in quality manpower. So the internationalization at home is the idea, where we are trying to bring in foreign universities and foreign faculties into India and establish their campuses in India, bringing a new clause into the education system that is expected to be coming up very, very soon. Then again, healthcare has been another important focus. Foreign universities and export of educational services, as we have already discussed, the various online programs and transfer of credit from these foreign universities have again become important. Study in India program has been launched to bring in more foreign remittance, and the idea is we are trying to bring in foreign students into India in the various universities. So developing student cities that would be much more safe, and bringing in scholarship programs for them, giving them niche studies and specific programs on oriental learning, indigenous programs like yoga, meditation have been focused under Ayush a lot. Similarly, we are talking about promoting educational fairs. So some of the examples of the fairs have been mentioned. Cross-border mobility for medical and treatment has become very, very important. So the countries where doctors are allowed with OCI cards are the following nations. So again, important, this could be a very direct direct question that could be asked. Then for education, we have e-learning, distance learning, online learning, study abroad program, more mobility for teachers, and bringing in a thrust for vocational education. Now, these all things we have discussed under the National Education Policy. So just go back and check out the videos on National Education Policy. A series of 6 videos have been covered. India Post is again important. Now, India Post has recently issued, identified 13 more foreign post offices for clearance of import and export of goods. These foreign offices would be set up in the following countries, and some of those have already been functioning. The list of those have been given here. Then we have the UPU, the Universal Postal Union, which is started in 1876. It was formed initially in 1874 at Bern in Switzerland, and the idea was to expand the postal services, and this should not be binding in nature. Later on, India adopted a 13-digit barcoding system for tracking the consignments. The first two talk about the products and the last two talk about the country. So if we say IN, it says it originates from India. So that's an example that has been given here. Now, similarly, APPU, which is the Asia Pacific Postal Union, has been established with its headquarters in Bangkok and a training academy at Lasky in Bangkok again. Then you have the EMS service, which is the equivalent to International Speed Post. You have the service which was extended to the following countries, again important, in 2019. So this could be again a very important question for your prelims point of view. So make sure that whatever we are highlighting here, you are going through those topics very, very carefully. The next is NRA being established. Now, NRA would be conducting the various recruitment tests, and there that would be mainly for the Group B and Group C services. As of now, it would have 6 regional offices, and the estimated cost initially would be there with nearly 1,500 crores. Then you would have an online set exam, which is the common entrance test, that would be held mainly for multiple government jobs, and there would be 3 levels: graduate, higher secondary, and matriculate level, under which you could appear. The score would be valid for 3 years. There would be no restriction on the attempts. The best of all attempts would be taken into consideration. And then you have some of the salient features of NRA, the National Recruitment Agency, that has been mentioned. The most important one is the standardized testing and the set, the biannual set, and the set of scores that would be taken into account. Similarly, you would have multiple languages besides Hindi and English. There would be various mock tests that would be available. A standard curriculum would be designed for the students, and then you would be having separate specialized exams for specialized branches that is required. For example, if there is postal services or railway services, you would have specialized tests focusing on those aspects once you qualify the set exam, that is the general exam. Then RRBs, then again you would have, those would be conducted through the CBT or as a online based examinations. Mission Karma Yogi is basically aiming to prepare civil servants to have more technology building and bring in more transparency into the system. Also, we have a national program for civil service capability building, which is an online training program with internet-based government training program and Karma Yogi platform. And then we also have transition from rule-based to role-based for HR learning. Civil service positioning, the framework for roles, activities, and competence, the FRAC approach, is very, very important. And we are also trying to make it available to all civil servants in India. So those are some of the key highlights that we have seen. And then lastly, UN at 75. So 75th anniversary of UN has been marked in 2020. So UN again becomes a very, very important topic. The major organs under UN, this we have covered in our class on NCERT class 11th. Political science in detail, United Nations, its structure, and the functioning of the various structures. So very, very important. Cover this in detail. Specifically important for this year's mains, because this time we have the 75th anniversary that has been marked. So those were some of the highlights that we have discussed. We would be covering Yojana and Kurukshetra on a regular basis. So stay tuned for many more updates from our side. Have a wonderful day ahead.